Good morning. I now have the pleasure to introduce the speakers of our Patient Advocacy Spotlight. No stakeholder group is more important than the patient in the design, the development, evaluation, and deployment of our mHealth solutions. We have two exceptional presenters this morning to give the patient perspective on mobile health. Our first presenter is Donna Cryer. Donna is the president and CEO of the American Liver Foundation. She's the first patient to lead the organization in its 30-year history. She has a diverse experience in law, public relations, and patient education and advocacy. And she currently serves as a patient representative to the Food and Drug Administration. Our second speaker will be Mary Ann Sterling. Mary Ann is CEO of Sterling Health IT Consulting, specializing in information technology, health policy, and communication. Mary Ann serves as executive in residence for the HIMSS Foundation. She has volunteered for the Alzheimer's Association and serves as ambassador to Senator Mark Warner's office for the implementation of the National Alzheimer's Project Act. So join me in welcoming our first speaker, Donna Cryer.
Good morning, everyone. I am very excited to be speaking with you this morning. I'm very honored as a patient and patient advocate and the leader of a patient advocacy organization to have the opportunity to speak with you this morning on this very crucial topic to healthcare, connecting the mobile health ecosystem to patient advocacy. I think the theme really for this entire few days that we'll spend here in the National Harbor is about connectivity. Connectivity whether in technical terms or in the very human terms that I would like to spend a few minutes with you this morning. Often I hear mHealth strategies about consumers, really everyone, all of us, and I think that using that construct of consumers is actually a barrier to the implementation, or at least to setting the expectations about implementation of many of the mHealth tools and technologies that are featured throughout this conference. And so I really want to have you take away from my presentation understanding of patients, e-patients, patient advocates, patient advocacy organizations, and as my colleague will speak following me, about caregivers. So I'd like to do this in a very non-techie way. There are no numbers on my slides, and not because my tech people or graphics people told me I couldn't have them. I thought deliberately, no numbers. There will be some mentions of some tech incubators and companies, but I really thought that I would present this story as a romance. So come with me, if you will. So connecting mHealth to patients and patient advocacy organizations is about bridging patient cultures, connecting e-patients even to patient advocacy organizations themselves, you may not imagine, is also a bridging of two very different patient cultures. I feel very privileged and honored to live in both worlds, to be DC patient on Twitter and in my blog, and to be the CEO of a very traditional patient advocacy organization and a consultant to many before that. And so when I thought of how to explain the two personas to you, any of you who are in fashion, I thought, well, the e-patients are sort of like Betsy Johnson. They're wild, they're new, they're, you know, eclectic, they're energetic, they're engaging, but they're also very fragmented. Who is an e-patient? How do you find them? How many of them are there? What does it take to qualify as an e-patient? How would you work with them or connect to them if you did want to? And then the traditional patient advocacy organizations, if I were to create them in human form, I would think that they're sort of like Ralph Lauren. You know, they're well-funded, they're a little conservative, they have infrastructure, procedures, lots of procedures, staff. That's a great asset that that the traditional organizations have. They're very trusted by their communities as carriers of messages, as a stamp of approval on things that are new, they're connected. Many have databases, as we do, to thousands, if not millions, of patients. And so while the e-patient movement is looking for structure and trying to mature to the next level, and what does their governance look like, the traditional patient advocacy organizations have nothing but governance and structure and things. And so I think that through this, I propose a marriage. So the implication for e-health is that the advantages of the e-patient movement are early adoption of new technologies, rapid dissemination through social media. They're also highly critical, which I would pose is a very good thing for you, because you get this very knowledgeable feedback very quickly, sort of a lean startup type of feedback that's necessary for you to get to that next iteration of an mHealth technology and to make it better. So there's so much value in the e-patient community. There is a lot of value in the traditional patient organization community. There is an education process, there are review processes that provide credibility, there are opportunities to do pilot studies, clinical trials, translational studies, surveys to large groups of people. And we are also, very rarely have we been thought of as a channel marketing partner. So having participated in a lot of demo days and mentoring some companies coming out of tech incubators, they're always looking for channel marketing partners, or at least they should be. But they're not thinking about the traditional patient advocacy organizations who do have access and who are piloting new programs annually, if not more frequently, and can really be a great conduit to having more people aware of and using your mHealth solution. So in this marriage, in this lovely marriage of our Betsy Johnson wearing e-patient and our Ralph Lauren Polo wearing a traditional advocacy organization, there need to be rules of engagement. Bridging cultures is hard. Change is hard. Having people from different worlds work with each other is not an easy thing. As those of you who are trying to explain the need for mHealth, perhaps within your own institutions or companies, there needs to be some rules of engagement. And so those that I think are really important, at least to bridging the cultural divide between patients and e-patients, are that, particularly coming from the foundation side, from the traditional patient advocacy side, we needed to invite the e-patients and e-patient innovators into our organization. They're not going to naturally come to us, sometimes rightly so. There are many organizations that's rather hostile to innovations. So we need to invite them in. We need to create forums where they know that they're welcome, that there's a place for them, that we want to hear these new ideas, that we are open. The second step, these sort of second rule of engagement, would be to engage influential champions. You know, who gets it within your organization already? And this is not a factor of age or even personal technological savvy. As I found on my board of 20, the support I got for new innovations and a case study I'll share with you in a moment was from a hepatologist who has been practicing literally as long as I have been alive. And he was my most influential champion and helped persuade others that this was something that at least we would try. The third rule would be to expose traditional stakeholders to e-patient potential using problems defined by traditional stakeholders. When I came into my organization saying we were going to be patient-centered and we were going to vet these mHealth options to integrate into our programs, there was a deer in the headlights look. So what does that really look like? What does that really mean? How can you provide demonstrations and examples as quickly as possible? And I found that the best way was to focus those innovations around answering questions that your board or your staff already cogitate on, already what keeps them up at night, and answer those questions first using these new tools, and I think you'll bring a lot of people on board. And then finally, to help meld those cultures and the needs of both that sometimes conflict, create a process that engenders the credibility and sometimes the very long processes, very bureaucratic processes that traditional patient advocacy organizations have, going through medical review and board review and layers of review, uninvented yet, but that do have the advantage of lending credibility. How can those work faster than normal? How can you create sort of a product cycle within a traditional patient advocacy organization that can actually move at the speed of mHealth? So this is what we've done inside the American Liver Foundation. We created an innovation council as part of our corporate roundtable, but a little separate, so that we could invite just creative people who had new ideas. And our strategic question as an organization was, how do you change healthcare to better serve liver patients? We really hadn't asked such a pointed question before. And we created specific questions, challenges, if you will. I know we're all in this room familiar with design challenges and innovation challenges and hackathons. And so we designed some challenges that would answer questions that matter to liver patients. So the Innovation Council was to create a platform to focus emerging technologies and innovation on problems that matter to liver patients, such as how do you accelerate a newly diagnosed patient up the learning curve to be an expert patient, so they understand their treatment choices and options about their disease. How do you do that better and faster, whether someone is in a rural area or in the middle of a city right next to a transplant institute? And we wanted to be able to facilitate the introduction of these new technologies to healthcare systems and providers. So it would really be a win-win. It wasn't just about us getting our problem solved. How could using this platform, how can using the assets of the organization help accelerate the adoption of the most promising technologies into actual practice? And so examples of some of the innovators that we invited in to present at our first Innovation Council was OraSure or OraQuick. Now we know them for the rapid HIV testing, and there's also rapid HCV testing to help us increase and extend testing in a variety of settings. Inquisit Health came out of the Blueprint Health tech incubator in New York and facilitates patient-to-patient or caregiver-to-caregiver peer support in a way that's a great supplement to our live support groups, and also allows us to erase barriers of geography and time and connecting patients to the answers that they need. And Ginger IO, originally a connection from Pipette that came through the Rock Health Tech Incubator, helped us understand how we might be better as a foundation creating mHealth adherence support and risk prediction tools. And I'm really excited to say that one of the our presenter from Ginger IO has actually been sworn in as a Presidential Innovation Fellow. So I really think, and all of these have either gone on to the progeny of this romance, the progeny of this marriage, if you will, have been contracts with the hospitals who attended the Innovation Council, or contracts or pilots with the foundation itself, or exciting new fellowship and design contests. So I think that the marriage of e-patient energy and traditional organization structure holds a lot of potential, and I thank you for allowing me to share that with you today.